So Shannon Mallory is here. He is the ag educator for the Kay County OSU Extension Office. Good morning.
Good morning, Beverly. How are you?
I'm great. How are you? I love the sunshine.
I was going to say, I thought I was late this morning because of how bright it was outside.
I know. I like it. I like it a lot.
Normally when we come in here, it's just barely starting to get light. So, right. Or I say normally past a month or so. Yeah.
So last week we talked about those huge round hay bales and how to store them. So you said last week that we would talk more about the hay bales, but this time how to feed?
Yeah, we're going to talk about the different options for feeding them and how much loss is associated with each of those options. Certainly we're not going to cover all of them. I mean, I'm not going to cover like, oh, you leave it on the tractor and fork it or something. I don't know. We're going to talk about the common ways that people feed.
So some people do leave it on the tractor and let them come wait a minute.
And I'm sure there's people that get real crazy
I'm thinking that's a good idea.
anyway. But number one, round bales just loose in the pasture. I drive by and do see people do this from time to time, where they just lay the round bale, they cut the twine off, and they let the cows have at it. Certainly, you're not having to buy additional pieces of equipment or something to store that, like to hold that, but it is literally the most inefficient way to feed hay, especially in most cases where this isn't one day's worth of hay. That hay is going to sit out there for probably 2 weeks or so. Cows like to lay on it.
That's what I'm thinking. Yeah. Walk on it and trample it into the mud where they can't eat it at that point.
So. Usually you're well past 50% of that hay bale lost. So unless you're getting free hay somewhere, which I don't think there's a whole lot of people doing that, you're losing half your hay doing it that
so
way.
So waste not, want not.
Waste not, want not, exactly.
Right.
The next way is round bales unrolled. Now, this is kind of a cool way. It's relatively innovative. One thing I will say, it's a great way to make sure that all of your cattle are getting some forage. You unroll it in a long strip. Your bossy cattle kind of get their area, and the weaker cattle, I guess is the right word, go to the other side and are able to get their grass. So that is one advantage to this. But again, it's still something that's on the ground that can be trampled. I've seen these unrolled bales that are out there where cows are laying on them or trampling them. But one of the other problems with it is it's usually, again, we unroll the whole bale and we've only got 10 cows in that pasture.
Right.
Well, this is going to sit out there for a week. We're going to have chances of rain. We're going to have all kinds of things that could cause that problem. If we could unroll half of it, we'd greatly reduce our loss. The losses associated with round bales unrolled, if it's 7 days a week, it's about 40% loss out there. But if we only feed enough for 2 or 3 days or the time that we plan on coming back, that can be as low as 15%. So we're doing a lot better
by
feeding the right amount of hay to them during that day.
So I have a question.
Yes.
How do you unroll a bale?
Right.
I mean, I'm not a farmer, so I'm just curious. How do you unroll those large bales?
It's the opposite of when you roll it up. I'm kidding.
This is educational.
There you go.
I'm learning.
Thanks, Shannon. Yeah.
Thanks, Shannon.
No. So anyway, when you do roll up hay bales, they do go in a spiral pattern as you roll them up, and you wrap them with that net. You literally have these, some people will run a rod right through the middle of them and put them on something that's kind of a spool.
Okay.
Other ones, there's just, and you'll see them on the back of truck beds, where it just kind of has these two arms that clamp on the side of it, and they're on bearings, and you can unroll it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have seen those, but
exactly,
I hadn't seen it done. But
yeah, you'll see the feed trucks, as some people call them. You know, they look like a normal pickup, and then they've got a flatbed on the back with some spikes or something like that, and people can unroll them.
Okay.
Yeah. So the next one is round bales in a hay ring, which is probably the most common in our area. This one here does have loss associated with it, but just by feeding it in a hay ring, we greatly reduce that loss.
Okay.
We're not talking about how we stored it or anything, but just the way we put it in that hay ring, one day we're at about a 5% loss, you know, if that's going to be how quickly they eat it. 7 days, we're only at about a 6% loss.
Okay.
So it holds that hay together really well. It keeps those animals from trampling it. And then in addition, they're able to, it's able to kind of stay together in that bale a little bit and not have as much weather loss. There's a lot of good things about it. It's pretty easy to do. you know, all you got to do is lift it, get a lighter one and lift it and put it over it. I'll tell you, there's even better types, types with a solid bottom, sheet metal bottom or rubber bottom, where it's a full sheet that keeps that hay from coming out of the pipes, is the best one. But any hay ring is going to reduce your loss.
So if you don't have a hay ring right now, it would be a great investment.
It would be a great
investment. Save a lot of money in the end.
I mean, if you think about it, you know, let's say a round bale is $50. You're losing right now 20% of it. That's $10. You feed 50 bales a year. $500,
right?
You know, and a hay ring cost probably about $200. So it would pay for itself, hopefully in one season, for sure in two seasons out there doing that.
Okay.
The final ones are the large and small square bales. If you want to feed your livestock small square bales every single day, it is the most efficient way to feed them. But I'll tell you,
time consuming sounds
exactly.
like though.
I don't want to feed my animals.
And if the winter months come or it's cold,
maybe it gets
you'll be out there every
the
day
and you can't get to them, or you know, something like that.
That could be a problem.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. So if you want to feed small square bales and flake off a little flake every day and give them the exact amount, more power to you. You're being very super efficient, but it's labor intensive.
Right.
Yes. And then the final one is large square bales, which we usually flake off and toss into the pasture. And that's going to, I think, more of the reduced loss from that is feeding the exact amount that the animals, they're going to eat largely what you've put out there in 1 or 2 days.
Okay.
And it's not going to have a chance to get weathered.
So you need to estimate before you put it out.
Exactly. To find out how much to feed. But yeah, so there's lots of different ways to feed hay. Overall, it boils down to feed hay in small amounts or in a feeder to minimize the waste. Feed hay and store hay in well-drained areas. We don't want it, you know, behind a terrace or something like that where it's going to accumulate water and when the cows trample and get it muddy.
Right.
You know, feed hay stored outside before hay that's already stored inside, kind of intuitive.
Right.
And then match the hay feeding system to your labor availability. You know, if it's just you, maybe round bales are a good way to go.
That might be the best way, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Before we leave today, I want to congratulate. We had 10 Master Gardener graduates.
Congratulations
they
to all of them.
Finished their 11-week class, and I wanted to read their names and congratulate them on the radio. Sheridan Pinkering, Jim Frost, Dalton Lacey, Catherine Long, Carol Keffer, Rita Stewart, Kevin and Nancy Rowe, Donna Price, Janice Brandstetter, and Sonny Stolhan. Congratulations. I always get worried when they take the test that someone's not going to do well, and they all made above a 90%.
So, nice. Yeah. Way so, to go. Congratulations to them.
We're super happy for them, and they get to join the wonderful Master Gardener organization, and we're looking for new people for next fall. We're going to do a class as well.
So. Okay, so once you're finished, what does a Master Gardener do once they finished and got their certification? Is that what it is they've
right.
got right
so,
now?
So okay. they've completed their training.
Okay, the training.
So they're still, I guess, not a full-fledged Master Gardener. We do ask that they do 20 community service hours and 20 continuing education hours the year after they graduate to meet the full Master Gardener requirements to become a Master Gardener, which we offer. Well, more than that, you know, people always tell me, man, that sounds like a lot. And I'm like, well, you know, just the fair, you can go 2 days and that's 8 hours
right.
each day.
Yeah, so it's fun things then.
It's fun
lots
things,
of fun community.
Exactly. There's
community
lots of
things.
Different types of opportunities and stuff like that.
So. All right, so if somebody's interested, when is the next class for Master Gardening?
I don't have a date set
yet,
but it will be fall, probably starting sometime mid-August and going until early November.
All right, next year.
Yeah, next week. Next year, thank you.
Next year, okay. All right.
But anyway, 580-362-3194 if they want to reach us.
All right, or they can find you in the basement at the courthouse at Newkirk, right?
Beverly, I have a small bit of news.
Uh-oh.
We moved furniture in.
Okay.
We were very lucky. We got new office equipment. We moved furniture in last week. So the moving process has started. We'll see when we actually get in there. With the
so close.
It's happening.
So in the next couple of weeks, before Christmas then.
I sure hope so.
I'm pretty sure
Christmas.
You will if you're moving furniture in. All right, thank you for coming in, Shannon. Great information as always. Appreciate you stopping by the studio. If you need more information, call 580-362-3194.
Thank you, Beverly.
All right, thank you. Here's Journey on KLOR.